Kansas City in the United States, there's a really rather beautiful hotel, Hyatt Regency, I think it's called. 43 stories tall, 733 rooms. It's really quite the thing. It was opened in 1980. Right about a year later, something changed. Something changed. Something drastic. Okay, something tragic happened. Take a look at the picture here, and you will see on the other side, I'm shining a little light on that, on the other side, you see that opening there? See, so you see this walkway that connects this side of the hotel with that side of the hotel? Okay, there were more of those walkways here and here and maybe here. 1,600 people would crowd into the foyer area Friday nights for what was called a tea dance. One journalist said that this was a phenomenon, a weekend phenomenon in Kansas City. It was the thing to do, the place to be seen. It was, I don't want to call it high society, but it was the thing. People would go to these tea dances, 1,600 of them. But something unfortunate happened. The walkway connecting one side of the hotel and the other side of the hotel, the fourth floor walkway, collapsed. It collapsed down onto the second floor walkway. And both walkways, 64 tons, I don't know what that is in tons, 64 tons of steel and glass and concrete and whatever else collapsed onto the people below. 114 people died. Yeah, I'll show you that again. See, that's where they were, the walkways. And that's what it looked like afterwards. 114 people died. More than 200 people were injured. And I'll tell you why. It all happened because of an engineering error. You see those little rods there? The walkways weren't secured correctly. Those little rods were never going to be strong enough to hold the walkways up. They were virtual time bombs. It was just a matter of time. They were going to fall. As soon as they had enough people standing on there for long enough, down they were going to go. And down they went. Now, I don't want to traumatize you, but can you imagine what it would have been like to be on one of those things and say, oh my goodness, I'm falling? To just, I don't know what you would think. Oh, this can't be good. Down you go. It wouldn't seem real. Might have been a whole lot worse for the people down below looking up and saying, what in the world? Falling. Because of an engineering error, someone did something wrong. Down it all came. If you have basophobia, the fear of falling, then you're not alone. There are Christians who have a sort of a spiritual kind of basophobia, a fear of falling spiritually. And falling spiritually isn't good. There have been some catastrophic, cataclysmic, spectacular and all the wrong way falls where people have fallen in grace or actually from grace. But I've got good news for you tonight. In Jude verse 24, the Bible speaks of God as he who is able to keep you from falling. Isn't that good news? That's really good news. God is able to keep you. Look at what Isaiah said in chapter 41 and verse 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And the Bible says this in Hebrews 1 and verse 3, speaking of Jesus, who being the brightness of the Father's glory and the express image of the Father's person. And look at this, upholding all things by the word of his power. Where would you be without God upholding you? I'm going to tell you the difference between a good person and a bad person. And you know, we've talked about this during question time. Heaven's not for good people, it's for holy people. But in the eyes of your average Joe in the street, the difference between a good person and a bad person isn't bloody-mindedness, it's not grit and determination, it's not trying hard. The difference between spiritual success and spiritual failure, those are better terms, is whether or not God is holding you up. And it's not that God will or won't. He will if you let him. So someone who's spiritually successful, someone who's having an actual vibrant relationship with God, is somebody who is being held up by God. You don't want to be without God holding you up. There was Peter walking on water and momentarily or in the moment somehow took his eyes off Jesus, took his faith off Jesus, and down he went. But thank God, he was kept from sinking, not because he was a good swimmer, not because he had floaties on his upper arms, not because of one of these things around his waist. He was kept from sinking by Jesus' mighty right hand, who held him and kept him from sinking. The world we live in is filled with temptation, and not one of us is a match for the power of the devil. But the Bible says these wonderful words, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, greater is he that is where? In you than he that is in the world. So the key to Christian living isn't your successful determination. It's not your training. It's not your, I want to say it's not your theology, but you that's right and wrong all at the same time. It's not whether you try hard. The key to success spiritually is surrender to Jesus. Success spiritually, a victorious Christian experience, is when Jesus lives his life in you. It was Paul who wrote to the church at Colossae, and he said that the mystery of the gospel is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Same man wrote to the Galatians. He really banged on this drum. He said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. That's what he does. If you are going to be spiritually successful, and I got to find another phrase because I'm a little bit worried that you might not resonate with that. If you want to have a true Christian experience, the key is whether or not Jesus lives his life in you. Whether you've surrendered, opened up your heart, and said, Lord, live in me. Now, how does that happen? Here's how it happens. 1 John 4, verse 13 says, by this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his what? That's how. So let Jesus live in your life. How does that happen? It happens through the operation, through the working of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings into your life the personal presence of Jesus Christ. Look at 1 John 3, verse 24. Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him and he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the what? Spirit whom he has given to us. So how do you get the Spirit? In the book of Acts, a man named Simon offered money so that he could buy the gift of the Holy Spirit. He was told, no, that's not how it works. Your money perish with you, as a matter of fact, is what Peter said. So if you can't buy it, you can't deserve it, you can't earn it. How does one receive the Holy Spirit in her life, in his life? We read Jesus' words in John chapter 14, starting in verse 15. He said, if you love me, do what? That's what he said, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, another comforter, some versions say, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Jesus said, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. How is it that Jesus comes to us and abides in us? He does so through the Holy Spirit. He promised that the Spirit would be sent to and given to the world. And then he tells us how the Holy Spirit is to actually be received. Don't miss this. This isn't rocket science. It's far more complicated. But look how simple it is. Jesus said, if you then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them who, what? Ask. I'm going to ask you a question. Don't answer me out loud. When did you last ask for the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit awaits your demand and your reception. If you would just ask, God will give the Holy Spirit into your life. And then after you've asked and you've said, thank you for that, you believe. And the Spirit of God is in you, is dwelling in you. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. This greatest gift is received after we ask for the gift of the Holy Spirit. brings to you the personal presence of Jesus Christ. Not everybody can drive a Bentley. Not everybody can live in a luxury apartment in a high-rise in downtown Melbourne. But everybody can have the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is infinitely more valuable than either of those things that I mentioned. Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it will be given to you. The Holy Spirit is that gift that makes the great difference in a person's life. Jesus was speaking one day and he explained the role, the special role of the Holy Spirit. He said, when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment to come. And then 5 verses later, Jesus said, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into what? All truth. Ooh, think about that in the context of what we've been talking about. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will tell you things to come. So the Spirit comes, convicts you of sin. No, you don't want to do that. Of righteousness, this is the way, walk you in it. Of judgment to come. Ooh, this is serious. There's a judgment. There's a matter of salvation and damnation. Savedness and lostness. By the way, my friend, this is not a game. Christianity is not a game. Let me speak to young people here. Your parents say, go to church. Your parents say, read the Bible. Your parents say, God loves you. Listen, this is not a matter of, should I do my parents' thing or not? Hold on a minute. God loves you and wants you to be saved. This isn't a game. This isn't a maybe, maybe not. This isn't a should I not. This is life and death, eternal life and eternal death. And the Holy Spirit comes and speaks to all of us and says, this is a serious business. There is a judgment to come and we want to take that seriously. And then God's Spirit is given to guide us into all truth. So what does that mean? That means, and think back to our questions tonight, that means that if God says, this is my will for your life, and you say, never, I'm not doing that, who are you resisting? You're resisting the Holy Spirit. Why in the world would you do that? God speaks. He says, come on now, let me draw you, let me grow you, let me have you. And you go, no, that's the Holy Spirit you are resisting. And it's not wise to resist the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. The Holy Spirit reveals new things to you. He says, you didn't know that. People have been coming to this series. They've said, I didn't know that. I'm in because this is the will of God. This is the word of God. I want to follow the truth of God's word. The Spirit of God is sent by God so that we can grow spiritually. Too many of us stagnate. If you planted some sweet corn in your backyard, you'd grow that thing to be nothing. Nothing. The action is taking place under the ground. And then there'd be a little sliver of green, and then it would grow up. And then before long, there'd be these little ears of corn on there. And what if it stopped? You'd never have corn to eat. And you'd go back to the fellow who sold you the seeds, and you'd say, what is this? He might say, it's Christian corn. Just like Christians who come to Jesus and it's all great to begin with, and they start to grow and they get to about here and pop. Don't even tell me anything else. Don't tell me I'm wrong about that. I'm not wrong about that. My church teaches this. This is what I learned. It's like someone in year 5. What do we call it in Australia? Year 5 or 5th grade? I'm hearing both. Year 5, grade 5. It's like a kid in grade 5 saying, don't be explaining physics to me. I learned science already. I'm satisfied with 5th grade. The Holy Spirit will come to you and will grow you. Will grow you. You know, you might be satisfied with just high school. But the truth of the matter is, in most cases, a bachelor's degree would really add to your experience. The truth of the matter is, in most cases, even if you have a bachelor's, a master's would add to your knowledge. That's what I'm saying. A doctorate would add to your knowledge. Postdoctoral work would add to your knowledge. But most of us Christians, we bail. I mean, like 10th grade, we're done. The Holy Spirit says, let me keep growing you. Let me keep educating you. Let me have more and more of your life. There's more work to be done. And when we say no, we are telling the Holy Spirit, nah, not interested. So what happens when the Holy Spirit speaks? And we back off instead of moving on with the Lord. Well, this is what Jesus spoke about in Matthew chapter 12. He said, "Therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, people. But the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven." That's interesting, right? I'll forgive everything, but I won't forgive everything. He goes on to say, anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come. Wait a minute. This is contradictory, maybe. Maybe. Well, you know it's not, because it's not. So how do you understand this when Jesus said, when John wrote, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Except that. He didn't say accept that, but accept that. The Bible tells us the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. Interesting. Merciful, plenteous in mercy in the same verse. God's really trying to make a point. Psalm 86 and verse 5, for you, Lord, are good and ready to forgive. The question isn't, is God ready to forgive? The question is, are we ready to be forgiven? Peter was preaching at Pentecost under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in Jerusalem just a few weeks after Jesus died. The Holy Spirit began speaking to the hearts of people and they experienced conviction. Word of God says they were pricked in their hearts. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? The answer came back, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is that gift given by God that speaks to your heart, maybe quietly, perhaps gently. Surrender your heart to Jesus. Give your life to God. Follow the teachings of the Bible. So what happens if you just say no? What happens if you resist what God is asking of you? Then it becomes harder to hear God's voice. It's like hitting the snooze button on an alarm clock and going back to sleep. In Ephesians 4 and verse 30, it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. How do we grieve the Spirit of God? You could grieve the Spirit of God by going on in a way that God does not want you to go, by persisting in sin. You could grieve the Spirit of God by failing to follow Jesus when he calls you in a new direction. You can grieve the Spirit of God by sins of commission, things you commit, things of omission, sins of omission, things you omit, things you do, and things that you don't do. It doesn't get easier to follow God if you wait. You know what happens? I'm going to tell you what happens. Now, I don't mean to rub anybody's fur the wrong way, but this is what happens. There's a dear lady sitting in the congregation, say, and she's like, yeah, I want to be baptized. I want to follow Jesus. But my husband doesn't want that. Now, of course, you need to consider domestic dynamics. But if your husband wants to be lost, what do you want to be lost with him for? If your husband's dragging his feet, why do you want to drag your feet too? It doesn't get easier the longer you wait. No, you need to say to your husband, or husband, you need to say to your wife, you do what you got to do. I got to follow Jesus. And it may well be that your example is the example that your significant other needs, your spouse needs, to go on and actually make a decision. You see? The Holy Spirit's calling you and you're saying, yeah, but what's the Holy Spirit saying to him or her? Oh, no, you got that wrong. We're all different. We're all in a different place. You mustn't wait. You can't wait. You can't afford to wait. You should never wait. It's the Holy Spirit. You're not waiting. You're not keeping the preacher waiting. Don't worry about him or her. You're not keeping the people at church waiting. Don't worry about them. You're keeping God waiting. Jesus died for you. He's still got nail prints in his hand saying, see, I love you this much. He still has scars in his forehead, is what we believe. He's saying, this is how much I love you. I demonstrated that by dying for you. You don't want to keep the Holy Spirit waiting. No way. The Bible says that we should not quench the Spirit of God. Oh, here's one from James. To him who knows to do good and does not do it, to that person it is sin. You don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit of God. You know that this is not God's will, but you do it anyway. Or you know that this is God's will and you do it not. Oh my, why would you do that? This would be quenching the Spirit of God. This is Jesus. This is the one who died for you. You know the story. God so loved the world that he sent Jesus, his own son, to ransom and rescue the sinful, hard-hearted world. This is Jesus saying, don't die. You don't have to die. Sin causes death, but you don't have to die. I died for you. I've opened up the doors of heaven. You just need to walk in. And we say things like, oh, but what about this in my life? What about that? What about my little, I'm not even going to name them, some of the things I've heard in the last few days from people who, I don't want to give up this. Oh, no, 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 no. Give up? You gain. You receive. Jesus says, I died for you so you can live. And you're waiting. Why? Jesus, the sinless one, died for us, the sinful ones. Jesus, the righteous one, died for us, the unrighteous ones. The grave couldn't hold him. He rose from the dead Easter Sunday morning, went to heaven after visiting some friends, came back assuring us that he is Messiah, the Lord. Now what are we waiting for? Heaven awaits. Before heaven, you can live life with a clean heart. You can live life free from guilt. You can live life free from condemnation. You can live right saying, I don't care who hates me. I know God loves me. I don't care who's against me. I know who's for me. What would you wait for? Jesus offers us the gift of eternal life. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, the Bible says. And we wait. Why? Oh no, ladies and gentlemen, God offers you salvation, the best deal you ever even heard of, the greatest experience. And we have the opportunity to honor the one who died for us, to live with integrity in the sight of a holy God, looking forward to eternity. The plan of salvation, the sinless died for the sinful. You mean for me? Yes, I mean for you. And I could tell you, well, I will tell you, if Jesus could save me, he can save anybody. If Jesus can reach down far enough to grab hold of my hand when I was in the pit and lift me out, he can do the same for you. Don't keep him waiting. In the book of Hebrews, we find a question that God cannot answer. It's Hebrews 2 and verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Hold on, we need to look at this closely. How shall we be saved if we... Let's try that again. How shall we escape if we neglect? That's the word. He didn't say reject. Let that sober you up. You don't have to look God in the face and say, nah, to be lost. You can simply say, that's a really great idea, God. That's a good offer you're making. I'll think about it. I'll wait. Yeah, I'll wait for my husband. I'll wait for my kids. I'll just wait. That's a really good offer you're making, Lord. I'll wait. Wait is one of the devil's favorite words. I'll wait. That would be neglecting so great salvation. Didn't he reject it? There are people dying who would think, yeah, it's a really good idea to be a Christian. Well, that's a good thing. I should have been one. Maybe that's a good thing. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? You know what kids can be like, right? Sitting in front of the TV. Hey, come and do the dishes, please. Okay. And then you call them again, and it's like they don't hear you. And they can come to the place where they actually don't hear you because they tune you out. And people who keep saying no to God, wait to God, yeah, later, give me a few more minutes to God, what you do is you tune God out. When the Holy Spirit calls, you don't want to ask God to wait. Romans 8:14, for as many as are what by? Led by the who? Spirit of God. These are the sons or the daughters of God. A true child of God hears the voice of God and says, I must. I love him because he first loved me. I will live for him because he died for me. If you got any common sense, you'd say eternity. Who wouldn't want that? But even if there was no eternity, you would want to live in a way that honors God with your life. You would just want to do that. Jesus called some fishermen. He said, followed me. They follow me. They followed. I hear people who say, you know what I'm going to do, John? I hear it, but I'm going to go home and pray about it. pray about what? Lord, Jesus died for me, and now you want me to be saved. Do you think I should? Dear Lord, should I obey you? No. The only prayer you pray is a prayer of thanks. Thank you for the light. Now give me the grace to walk in the light. We don't wait to see what the Bible says. We know what it says. Some people say, I wait for a conviction. I wait to feel the right feeling. You're not saved by feelings. You are saved by grace through faith. And faith is accepting the word of God for what it says and allowing that to be worked out in your life. That is faith. Multitudes are going to come up in the wrong resurrection, 1,000 years too late, outside the New Jerusalem instead of inside. The truth was in the Bible all the time. Allow me to suggest to you tonight that you are not promised tomorrow. You're just not. This is why Jesus said, be ye also ready. He didn't say get ready. He didn't say circle a day on the calendar. He didn't say dicker around with the subject of baptism. Just follow the God of heaven when he calls. In the judgment, when many will be found lost simply because they neglected heaven-sent opportunities to be saved. Jesus said in John 5 and verse 40, you will not come to me that you might have life. David knew that the Holy Spirit wouldn't continue to call to him forever. And that's why he prayed in Psalm 51 and verse 11, cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. You know what God said in the days of Noah? He said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, or will not strive with man forever. There came a time that Noah went in and the door was shut. You know what that means, right? The rain hadn't started, but the door was shut. And when that door was shut, no one else could get in. No one. In fact, they didn't set sail for a week. You can imagine people outside, Noah, what's going on, Noah? You said it was going to rain, Noah. What's happening, Noah? They'd had their opportunity. It was too late. This is what happens in our experience, friend. One day it's too late. No, it's not too late for you now. If it was too late, you wouldn't be here and you wouldn't care. It's not too late for you. But the time comes when it is too late. So God says, do not wait until the door is shut. The unpardonable sin, the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, this thing that God cannot forgive, it's not a type of sin. Is it murder? Is it drug dealing? Is it human trafficking? No, no, no. Those things are not the unpardonable sin, as nasty as they are. They can be forgiven. The unpardonable sin is this. When you choose to ignore the Holy Spirit repeatedly and persistently, and you come to the place where you no longer hear the voice of God calling you to repentance, you have committed the unpardonable sin. It could be anything. God says, put down the bottle. And you say, I like the bottle more than you. And God speaks again and again and again. And you say, I'm not giving this up. That becomes your unpardonable sin. It's whatever you put between you and Jesus and refuse to have forgiven. God will forgive you of anything if you'll let him. But if you cling to that, if you hold to that, if you refuse to let God forgive you of your sin, this thing cannot be forgiven and it will become for you the unpardonable sin. I'm going to say it again. The unpardonable sin isn't a certain sin, a certain kind of sin. It's whatever sin you refuse to let go of. It cannot be pardoned because you refuse to confess it and give it to God. Whatever stops you giving your heart fully to Jesus, that becomes the unpardonable sin for you. God's going to shut the ark again. There's no need for you to be on the outside. Would you let your family member prevent you from following Jesus? Why would you do that? Would you let a job keep you from following Jesus? Why would you do that? Would you let tradition keep you from following Jesus? Doesn't make any sense. Would you keep some church tie? Would you keep that from you following Jesus? Would you let that keep you from following Jesus? Many people in this room, I am one of them, came to the place at some stage in our experience and we said, no, I've got to step out of this because the Bible is leading me. Be led by Jesus, the one who loves you and died for you. Remember, there's a parable in the Bible. Jesus had a, it wasn't Jesus. He told the story of a man who had a feast and he started inviting people to come. Folks were like, yeah, I'll be there. I'm coming. Yeah, free food. I will come. But some said, I'm not coming because I got married. And someone else said, I just bought an animal. And someone else says, I have some land. These were just excuses. These people were kept outside of the feast. Don't be kept outside of the feast. Why would you do that? In Acts chapter 24, we see the unpardonable sin happen. Starting in verse 24, and after some days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. So what would Felix do? What would he do? And after some days, he heard the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, this is Paul speaking, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid. Other versions say Felix trembled. And he answered, go away for now. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you. The Bible makes no mention of Felix calling for Paul. He died lost. Imagine having Paul preach to you of righteousness, temperance, self-control, and the judgment to come, and saying, maybe later, maybe later, maybe later. And the man was lost and not saved. Times it can be tough to live for Jesus. You find yourself with your back against the wall. I don't mean tough, but spiritually challenging. Surely it can. We don't always make the best choices, but we're growing, you know. God loves you enough to grow you, to work with you, to persist with you. You know what the Bible says? It says the long suffering of our God is salvation. How do you love that? God's patience equates to salvation for us because he waits. How long has he been waiting for you? And is he still waiting? He would like to stop waiting. Don't keep God waiting on you. There's no reason to do that. Don't keep God waiting. We think of what Daniel spoke of, a time of trouble coming such as never was. Revelation speaks of a crisis on planet Earth in Earth's last days. We read that God's people are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Well, who can be one of those people? You can, through the power of God. And that power comes through the gift of the Holy Spirit. There is power in the Spirit. The Spirit of God brings into your life the personal presence of Jesus, brings into your life the help that heaven gives. It brings into your life power, spiritual power, the power of Almighty God. You don't want to live your life without God's Spirit holding you up. You don't want to do that. Without the Holy Spirit in your life, there is no power. You don't want to live separate from God. You don't. Don't keep God waiting. Don't go on saying, no, God, no, God, no. When is the yes going to come out of your mouth? You could have said that yes a day ago, a week ago, a year ago, a decade or a generation ago almost, you know. You could have done that. But God wants to give you the gift of his Holy Spirit. There have been some impressive gifts given over the years. But I'm jumping ahead of myself and I shouldn't have done that. Look at another example. Paul speaking to Agrippa. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? He said, I know you believe. Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. There are people here tonight who are almost persuaded. It's not my job to persuade you. It's the Holy Spirit's role to speak to your heart and to convict you. And it's your role to respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit and say, Lord God, you've got me. Here I am. Take me. Have my life. This here is the Cullinan Diamond. It was found in South Africa just outside of Johannesburg. The largest uncut gem quality diamond ever found. You know, the government of the Transvaal colony, as it was at that time, gave it to King Edward VII as a gift. The thing was priceless. They gave it as a gift. The Hanging Gardens of Babylon were a gift given by King Nebuchadnezzar to his wife. What a gift. The Statue of Liberty was a gift given by the people of France to the people of the United States. You might be able to think of some gift, a special gift given to you. A birthday gift, a wedding gift, an anniversary gift, a Christmas gift. I'm sure you can. I'm sure you can think of some gift, maybe not the biggest, largest gift, but a special and a meaningful gift given to you by someone important. The greatest gift that was ever given to you was given 2,000 years ago. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. He gave him that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Is that gift special to you? The gift of Jesus. You can have it, the gift of Jesus. It will change your life. Don't be thinking, I must change my life. You accept Jesus, he changes your life. That's where the power is. Power is not in you. The power is in the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. And he will change your life. If you'll let him, he will change your life. What a gift. Friend, Jesus is coming back soon. You've never experienced anything like the second coming of Christ. It's the end of sin. It's the end of separation between us and God, the end of all of that. When Jesus comes back, he puts you and the Godhead back together inseparably forever and ever and ever in a very real form. We're not separated by the miles. We're not separated across the cosmos. Jesus is coming back soon. Will you be ready then? Will you be ready then? You can be ready then if you're ready now. How do I be ready now, John? Simply by saying, Lord, take my heart. I choose to be a Christian. Let me grow in you. You know, tonight we have some people who have made the decision. They want to be ready to meet Jesus when he comes back, and they want to grow in him. Are you ready? They have given their hearts to Jesus, and they've made the decision that they want to bury the old them in a watery grave, and they want to be raised up out of that water to walk in new life. And tonight, we have the privilege of witnessing that. And somebody's going to tell me soon just how ready we are. We should be close. And my hope, my prayer is tonight that as you witness people giving their lives to Jesus Christ in baptism, that you'll be inspired, that you'll be moved, that you'll be blessed, and that you'll say in your heart, Lord, I want to do that as well. Or Lord, whatever is wrong in my life, I want that to be made right. Lord, however you are waiting for me, I don't want you to wait any longer. I want you to have me. Is there anything separating you from God? Pastor Victor, would you lead us here and introduce our dear friend, Sophia, and we'll witness with joy.
This is Sophia Bongogo. Can you hear me? This is Sophia Bongogo. And tonight, because of her decision to be baptized, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Of course, the paparazzi have come out. And that's okay. You know, let's close the curtain and go again. Can somebody pull that across? That's what we're asking you to do. Thank you, Sam. Appreciate that very much. Oh, we've lowered one. That's beautiful. That was easy. Sophia has responded to the call of God in her life. And tonight, God is encouraging you, asking you to do the same, to respond to His call in your life. That response doesn't look the same for everyone. For some, it's baptism. If that's God's call on your life, tell God you'll keep Him waiting no longer. What we witness is somebody going into a grave. It's a watery grave. And then they come out of that grave, like Sophia, to walk in newness of life. It's all new now. Yeah, life has its ups and downs and its bumps and its scrapes, but there is a settledness now because God has your heart. He has your life. And if you've been baptized already and need no rebaptism, then tonight just rejoice and praise the Lord that God has given us the opportunity to witness people becoming one with Him. My friend is in the water with Phil and hopefully with a working microphone. He'll take it from here. Thank you, Pastor Flamenco.
Phil, this is a great moment for you. And believe me, there is great joy in heaven and also in our hearts. And because you have accepted Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord, and it is your desire to live for Him and to be a faithful servant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the name of Jesus, His Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We want to get the picture. We want to save this moment forever and remember it forever. It's not something that you want to forget. Think about the baptisms in the Bible. There was Philip led by God to the wilderness, Gaza, near Gaza in Israel. And he came across a man from Ethiopia who was reading the scripture. Do you understand what you read? How can I understand it if no one's prepared to explain it to me? Philip explained it to him. It was Isaiah chapter 53. And as they went on in the chariot, the man from Ethiopia said, "Here is water. What hinders me to be baptized?" He said, "If you believe in Jesus Christ with all your heart, you may." And he was baptized. And you know, notice he didn't say, "Oh, there's something keeping me." He didn't say, "I'm not sure." He didn't, "What about my family?" He gave an example by his faithfulness to his family and to people down through the ages. 2,000 years later, we're talking about that man. And when he came out of the water, the Bible says he went on his way rejoicing. He rejoiced all the way back to Ethiopia. You can think of the Bible of the man in Philippi, the jailkeeper, a hardened former Roman soldier, a man who had undoubtedly shed blood. Paul and Silas were in the prison in Acts chapter 16. There was an earthquake. Everybody's bonds were loosed. The doors of the jail swung open. Problem for the jailkeeper is he was asleep. He'd be executed for this. Paul and Silas called out, "Don't hurt yourself." He was going to kill himself. "Don't harm yourself. We're all here." None of them fled. "We're all here." The jailkeeper came to where Paul and Silas was, where Paul and Silas were. He brought them out. There's a beautiful passage in the Bible. It says that he washed their wounds. Beautiful. And then they washed away his sins. Well, God did that. But he was baptized. They baptized him. He rejoiced. This man was about to take his own life. And I don't know what, an hour or two later, he was receiving the life of Jesus. What a wonderful turnaround. What a great turnaround. And I want you to think of the baptism of Jesus, who was not baptized on account of his sin, but on account of ours. Even Jesus was baptized. That was the right thing, the appropriate thing. And he gave us an example so that we might follow in his steps. Jackie is following in Jesus' steps tonight. And this baptism's ever so slightly different. Jackie is seated, because when you see her arrive and depart at night, she's seated. She's in a motorized chair. There was someone who wanted to let something get in the way of baptism. Jackie might have been able to appeal to that as a reason why. But she loves Jesus supremely. And it's a beautiful demonstration of her love that she is giving her life to Jesus tonight in baptism.
Jackie Ryan, do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Jackie, because of your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and your desire to live a new life in him, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Come on and say amen. Amen. Coming back soon. Tonight I want to show you another baptism, a baptism with a bit of a difference. When our Readers Written team was in the state of Texas last year, we met a young lady named Isabel. And I want to share with you Isabel's story, and I hope and pray that you are inspired.
Well, my mother was an alcoholic and my father was always in prison. I remember always being able to go walk in and out the house as I pleased and being and hanging out with people, whoever I wanted to hang out with. I ended up in juvenile, yes. I was in alternative school. I even got expelled from middle school. I was using drugs to hide the pain, to numb the pain. To not think about what was happening in my life, and that just made things worse for me. I made up my mind, you know, I'm gonna do this, I'm just gonna leave, I'm gonna go out on my own, and whatever, you know, I'm not gonna turn to nobody, I'm not gonna ask nobody for help, I'm just gonna go and seek it at the right places where I know I could seek it. So I got myself ready and I took off walking. That's when Ophelia was driving down the road and she offered me a ride.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart.
As I got into her vehicle, you know, she asked me right away. She asked me, "What's your story?" I told her everything. Like, I couldn't lie to her about nothing. She right away told me that she was a lady from the church, that she has a house with open bedrooms in it, and that I didn't need to go to Harlingen to a shelter, that she would let me stay at her house. She had mentioned to me that there was a seminar, a 9-day seminar happening, and she would really like for me to go. The topic of that day, or the topic that stuck to me that day, was about baptism. Everything that he was saying, everything that I read in the Bible, was making sense. Like, finally I hear it coming from a person's mouth. It just really caught my attention, everything that he was explaining. So yes, at the end of that presentation, he said, if you want to get baptized, go talk to one of the pastors. And that's what I did. I went straight to one of the pastors that was at the door, and I told him I want to get baptized. Being that I had sinned so much and been in a lot of trouble and got in a lot of trouble and was led to so many things that I wasn't supposed to be led to, I knew I was ready, and I was waiting for that moment for a very long time. But I do want to say this: if you just make that decision to get baptized, to give yourself up to Him fully, leave everything that you love behind for Him, He will love you and make you feel love like you have never felt before.
So how is it with you tonight, friend? You've seen, well, four examples now of people who've given their lives to Jesus, and Isabel appealed to you. I want to do the same. Please do something for me now. You've been sitting long enough. Would you mind standing on your feet if you're able to do that? Stand on your feet with me, everybody. It's not a trick. It's not a game. Would you stand on your feet? There are people in this place who know now beyond a shadow of a doubt that they need to give their life to Christ fully and completely. I wonder if you would listen carefully to what I'm about to say. I'm going to invite you to make a decision and act on that decision. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, tonight's the night you're going to do that. Tonight's the night. Jesus waits for you with His arms open wide. He's welcoming, ready to welcome you into His heart. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm going to invite you tonight to do that. Secondly, if God has called you to be baptized and you have not been baptized, or if He's calling you to re-baptism or to make a profession of faith, then I want to call you as well. If God is calling you to unite your life with those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, then I want to invite you as well. And here's what I'm inviting you to do. I want to pray for you and with you, and I'm inviting you to step out from wherever it is you're standing right now and come and join me down here in the front. I know there are some of you, you've already told me, yes, this is what I'm going to do. Would you act on that now? If everything's okay between you and Jesus, then you have a job to do. That's to pray. Pray for the people around you. But if God is calling you, God bless you. If God is calling you, then respond to Jesus tonight as the music is beautifully sung and God speaks to your heart. Jesus invites you to come. Will you come to Jesus tonight and meet me down in the front here? God bless you. Here's what's going on. There's someone standing here tonight saying, I've got to go forward. I've been there myself. You stand and you hear the person make an invitation and you say things to yourself like, what about the people around me? It's very easy. Excuse me. That's all. Excuse me. you move to the side and the people around you are going to say, amen, that's all. What if someone sees me go forward? Yeah, you exactly. What if God sees you go forward? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Wouldn't that be great? It's right about now that the devil comes by right where you are and he puts some glue on the floor where your feet are. But remember, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Is God calling you? No, God isn't asking you to make a promise, just a declaration. I decide tonight for Jesus, a decision. I decide tonight for Jesus. If you've never given your life to Jesus, he's calling you to come to him tonight. If you have given your life to Jesus, but you know that you need to be baptized or rebaptized, then come. It doesn't mean you're going to be baptized tonight or tomorrow. Maybe. But that doesn't have to happen. You're on the journey. You're telling God, I'm on my way. I'm not keeping you waiting any longer. I'm coming. You've not ever made that decision. I'm going to keep the commandments of God now, all of them, including the seventh-day Sabbath. That's my desire. It's my will. Act on that tonight. If you've been far from God and you've got to come back, then Jesus is calling you tonight. Are you hearing his voice? I know you're hearing me, but are you hearing God? It's God who's speaking to you and appealing to your heart. And you're weighing it up now. God is saying, I have everlasting life. If you will just come forward. Oh, what difference does it make if I come forward? You know it makes a difference to act on a desire, to act on the prompting of God, to say to God, yes, please. I know there are other people here tonight who know they should come forward. And I can't keep you here all night, but I can keep you here a few more minutes. And God is calling to you. Don't worry about the family. Don't worry about the issues in your life. Just declare, Jesus, I need you and I want to follow you. As you hear more of this beautiful song and God calls to you, don't wait. Don't keep God waiting. There's nothing worth keeping God waiting for. Come and join us in the front so we can pray and you can go from this place saying, I know I'm a child of God. You want that. You want to be one with God tonight. As he calls you, come, listen, and come to Jesus tonight.
Jesus said, here I stand. Won't you please take my hand? And you said, I will.
Right now that God speaks to your heart and he says, what are you waiting for? God bless you. God bless you. I'm glad to see you here. God bless you. There are still people coming and there are still people waiting. You know, God does not want you to feel any undue pressure. But he doesn't want you lost. He wants you saved. I think there are some young people tonight who may have been waiting. Waiting on the Lord, waiting. What are you waiting for, young people? You've got the rest of your life ahead of you. Don't wait. Don't keep God waiting. Listen, friend, if you are standing in the right place tonight, if you're in the wrong place, come and join us down here. But if you're in the right place and you believe there's someone here in this place tonight who should be coming down here, but they're waiting for some reason, you go to that person and say, I'll come with you. Bring them down. Go to that person now and say, I'll go down there with you. Bring that person. It's worth issuing the invitation. It's worth it. Listen, I'm going to go through my little list again. If you're planning on being baptized or rebaptized, don't wait. We want to pray with you. If you're right up there in the cheap seats and you think it's such a long way down, it's not long. You know, I've gone on this long, I'll go longer for you. Up, out, down, around, it's worth making the journey. God bless you. There are more. God bless you. There are more. No, listen, don't wonder. That's you I'm talking to. That's you God is talking to you. He's speaking to your heart tonight and calling you. Don't wait. What's your decision? Is God calling you to bury the old life? What examples we've had tonight. We've had people come out of the water to walk in a new life now. They've been remade, reborn. You can be. That's not for the select few. That's for you too. Is God calling you? Come to Him tonight. If you've been far from God and it's time for you to come back to God. Come back to God. Leave a saved person tonight. Leave safe in the arms of God. God bless you, gentlemen. God bless you. And there are others. I know there are. And people are now starting to say, well, I know this can't go on much longer. And I don't want, God bless you. I don't want to wait too much longer. Don't wait. And you're going to go home tonight. You're going to justify it. Yeah, I waited. But the reason I did was, why? I didn't want to make a show. This isn't a show. This isn't a show. This is God calling your heart and saying, will you let me save you? Give that person next to you an example. I'm going. I'm going. I'm going to Jesus. I'm walking in His arms. Listen to the rest of the song and be blessed. And as God moves you, allow Him to move you from where you are and bring you down to the front. Leave this place with assurance. Leave having won a victory. Let Jesus win the victory in your life. Start your life again and know you are a child of God. Don't wait. We might not have tomorrow.
Tomorrow, I'll give my life. Tomorrow, I thought about today. But it's so much easier to say.
Tonight, you know we're down to the wire now. We're down to the wire. If you're up there and you need to be down here, I invite you to come. Jesus invites you to come. You're in the back. It didn't take long to walk from there to here. John, why? What difference does it make? Do you know what difference it makes when you walk through an open door rather than just sit and look at it and don't go through? That's the difference. That's the difference. The difference is you're going to leave tonight and know in your heart, I made a decision for Jesus. You're going to leave tonight and not say in your heart, I told God to wait. God bless you. I wonder if there's someone else, someone's else. I want to make sure that the people over here have room to actually get on down here, so help us with that. Yep, amen. There's another one. I think there's someone else in here tonight. You know, I want to encourage you to walk into the arms of Jesus. Don't tell Jesus to wait. Wait for what? would you wait for? What are you waiting for? As people are moving tonight, it makes it easier for you to move. Yeah, look, there's any number of people. God bless you, John. Don't wait over there. You come down here. God be with you, brother. Tonight, Jesus calls. He's calling. Continue to come. They're continuing to come tonight. You know, I can't see much past the lights, but if I could, I'd look you in the eyes and invite you to give your life to Jesus. He died for you. This isn't jargon. These aren't cliches. This isn't churchy talk. This is the gospel. Jesus died so you might live. He has eternal life for you. You want more than what this world has. And I know you at a time like this, what will I say to mum? How do I explain this to the kids? Let God take care of that. Let God take care of that. And if you wanted to explain to anyone, you'd say, I've chosen to follow Jesus. I've chosen to follow Jesus. What about this issue in my life? Fine. Bring that issue to Jesus. That's what you do. What about my sin? Bring your sin to Jesus. I don't feel like I'm good enough. Newsflash. You're not good enough. It's not about how good you are. It's about how good Jesus is. And he's good enough. He is good enough. Would you wait or would you come? Is there someone else before I pray who's going to come to Jesus tonight? We're going to pray together. We're going to commit you to God. You have the blessing of leaving this place tonight knowing you decided for God and you are saved. Saved in the arms of Jesus. Welcomed into the heart of God. I just sense God is telling me there's somebody who's doing this, you know? Who's rocking backwards and forwards. Who's thinking I should, but... Oh, wait, friend, wait. Or should I say, don't wait, friend, don't wait. Listen, God urges you just to take a step of faith, a step of faith, and he'll draw you, he'll call you, and you'll know, yes, I am a child of God. I know I am. I went forward one day. I was baptized. I'm a child of God. You can never erase that from my experience. I'm not about to change my mind, and I know God's not going to change his mind. There's somebody here tonight before I pray, even while I pray, you can still come. While every head is bowed and every eye is closed, you can still come. There's time for you, friend. There's time for you. And there's room for you in the arms and the embrace of God. He loves you. Jesus died for you. He says, let me give you that better life. Let me give you that new heart. If you're planning on being baptized, just come. Even if it's planned, even if you've been baptized tomorrow, just come and make this prayer of commitment. If you want to be one of those people who keeps God's commandments, all of them, you've not been doing that, tonight's your night. You can make that decision tonight. If you've been far from God and you realize it's time for me to come back to God, I must come back to faith in God now. This is the opportunity you have to walk into the arms of God. Would you do that tonight? You have somebody near you you're willing to bring? Are you willing to say to someone, come on, let's go together. Let's go together. One day together we're going up. We're going home. That's home. We're strangers here. That's home. I want you to go home with me. I want you to go home with us. Jesus wants you to go home with him. He's the one coming back to get you. And you would break his heart by saying no to him tonight, or by saying, wait, tomorrow. We're going to pray and listen for the voice of God. And if God is calling you to act on that impulse within your heart, just come. Just come. This means that you've made a decision for God. This means that you recognize God has made a decision for you. That's what that means. They've all got one of those, right? All got one. This means that you're a child of God, is what it means. That's what it means. This means that you've made a decision for Jesus. You've acted on the decision that he made for you. And when you go home tonight, you're, what in the world did I do that for? You're going to remember, oh, that's why. Because I gave my life to Christ. I made a decision for Christ. That's why I went. That's why I went. What does that mean? It means I got to go to work on Monday. It means I got to go to school. It means I got bills to pay. It means I still got an aching back. But when Jesus comes back, none of that matters anymore. I'm going to be with him forever, and that's not far away. Tonight, let's pray a prayer of thanks and assurance. Bow your head with me. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, in the name of Jesus, we come. We are thankful that you call us today and not to wait until tomorrow. We are thankful. I want to pray for each individual here who has made this walk down to the front. Lord, hold them in your arms. Remind them, you are a Christian. You believe in Christ. Remind them, Christ believes in you. Remind them, there's a mansion in heaven for you. There is a place prepared of God for you. Remind them, Lord, remind them as they rest upon their beds tonight. Remind them that life isn't going to be the same now. It's not the same, because we are children of the heavenly King. And one soon day when Jesus returns, we are going up to be with him forever. Remind each person, assure each one. Friend, as you've come forward tonight, God assures you, you are forgiven. You're not only forgiven, you are cleansed. Jesus takes your hand. He says, I'll guide you now. And it might be that you have a great understanding of what the future holds. It might be that you've walked into something and you're saying, what now? What now? Jesus now. Faith now. Trust now. Assurance now. Heaven now by faith. If you're standing tonight in the seats and you are standing there appropriately, take an opportunity to recommit your life to Jesus. Pray quietly in your heart and say, Jesus, make me yours again. Take my heart. My friend, if you're standing there and you should be here, I am praying for you now. Father in heaven, convict that one. That's what the Holy Spirit does. Convince that one. That's your role. It's your job. And I pray you'd never let that one go. Make it as impossible as possible for that person to find their way to that special place in your heart. Don't let them keep resisting and continue to fend you off. Instead, Lord, bring that person home to your heart. Tonight, Lord, in behalf of each person who's come forward tonight, I want to say thank you for your mercy and your grace. Tonight, Heavenly Father, victories have been won. Tonight, hearts have been made new. Tonight, futures have been changed, irretrievably changed, because our future now is bound up with the future of Jesus. Keep us and bless us. I commit these to you. They are yours. Keep them now and for eternity. We pray together in Jesus' name. Please say, amen. Amen. Amen.